Hello and welcome everybody to Inside IIM. My name is Ocean and I will be your host this evening. In January 2021, shockwaves were felt across the entire country when an IIM Ahmedabad student, Ms. Drishti Raj, allegedly committed suicide in her hostel room. On the surface, it might look like an unfortunate incident that takes place in a pressure situation and a highly competitive environment. But when we look at it closely, the decision to end one's life may not be so straightforward after all. When we map the rising number of untimely demises being seen across the country, a pattern evolves. Indian youth are seriously being affected by wide-ranging mental health issues. Many students are looking for employment as we speak. Many are en route to their B-school campuses, and many are about to begin preparing for competitive exams, journeys that are mentally challenging and highly competitive. No matter who we are or what we do, stress, anxiety, tension, failure, inferiority complex, all of these may ruin our experience of life, especially in the middle of a pandemic. To solve that problem for you, Inside IIM today has called on experts in mental health who will share practical steps that will not only help you address problems relating to these, but it will also make you stronger. Piyusha and Prerna, it is my pleasure to have you on the channel. Thank you so much for making the time. Let me ask you to briefly introduce yourselves to our audience, starting with Prerna.
Very good evening to everyone. My name is Prerna. I am a counseling psychologist by training, and I'm currently working with iCall Psychosocial Helpline, which is a field action project of Tata Institute of Social Sciences. I have had an experience of over 5 years of offering counseling services over technology-assisted mediums. That is briefly about me.
Okay, how about you, Piyusha?
Hi, everybody. Good evening. My name is Piyusha, and I am a psychologist by profession. I have over 2.5 years of experience in working with clients on diverse psychosocial concerns over the technology-assisted medium. And I work in the capacity of a program officer at iCall.
Definitely, truly a pleasure having you both on board. Let's dive straight in. Not making it to your dream B-school, business school, your dream internship, dream company, not securing a job, or securing a low rank, low marks on tests that may be important for you. All of these situations are really different facets of experiencing failure, and it could feel terrible. What are some specific ways you can share with us to cope up with failure?
Right. So certainly, so I think all of the, events that you have talked about, be it not making it to the B-school of your choice or not getting the internship that you had aspired to get, all of these are very significant life events, you know. So, of course, this is very important for every aspirant, every student, everybody who wants to do something in their career. And definitely when things don't turn out as we had envisioned, they are very stressful, they cause a lot of distress. I think, again, coping with that is because you mentioned the term failure. Now, why do we say that, you know, somebody is a failure, or why do we refer to ourselves as failures? That happens because there is a meaning associated with these life events, right? So not getting the internship of my choice or the job of my choice, that probably means that I am a failure, because that is the meaning that is associated with it, or that is the significance that is being associated with it, right? So again, when we look at it, or when we look at it from this perspective, it does cause distress, because I need to achieve this to be a successful person. If not, I am a failure, right? So maybe one of the ways, now, again, these perceptions are also guided by whatever is going around us, because again, we all have these definitions of what is an ideal B school, what is an ideal internship, what is a dream job that could make your career. So I think it is all coming from these perceptions. One of the ways of dealing with it is to realize that how your identity is way beyond these perceptions. Like I understand, it can be very shattering when you don't get what you had expected. However, your identity as an individual or what you can do as an individual, it is not just limited to getting into your dream job or getting into your dream internship. It is ultimately your abilities as an individual and a professional. So I think knowing one's strengths, also approaching it in this manner that, okay, maybe I have not gotten the reschool of my choice, but maybe I can get another opportunity that also may be very good for me. So instead of looking at yourself as a failure, that's what I have to say, Piyusha.
Yes. So to add to that, another point that comes up is sometimes the thought processes that we have regarding these life experiences is that I am a failure. We tend to internalize all our experiences and we tend to globally evaluate our identities and our experiences on the basis of this one significant, I mean, of course, it is significant, it is important, but we tend to evaluate our identity as a whole to this experience. So it's important to differentiate that, like Prerna mentioned, that yes, okay, this is an experience that I had and this was a terrible experience for me, but that doesn't make me a failure overall, or that doesn't mean that I'm a failure in every aspect of my life, or that doesn't even mean that I will be a failure always in the future. So it's important to reflect upon questions like, you know, so this has happened to me, and what is this failure trying to tell me, or how can I see this as an opportunity or as a learning experience for me to, you know, work on areas that might need more work. And like Prerna also mentioned, these ideas of what failure is, what especially what success is, comes from the, you know, dominant themes of, you know, us getting into B-school, us having our dream job, us getting into a particular B-school. So, you know, not being able to meet these standards, not being able to meet these ideals do cause a lot of distress to us. And it's very, very understandable. It's very normal to feel the distress. So it's also important to acknowledge and, you know, normalize these experiences. And at the same time, a shift in the mindset needs to be more from that, you know, from a critical point of view to a more compassionate point of view. So maybe talking a little bit about self-compassion. So it's important to view our failures or our life experiences kindly, rather than, you know, holding ourselves responsible and constantly criticizing and blaming ourselves for not being, you know, able to get through or not being able to do well. So it's important to incorporate self-compassion. It's important to be a little kind towards oneself when it comes to life experiences that include failure. And that is the shift that we need to have.
Right. So as somebody who's, let's say, experienced failure, your point is that the fact that it makes me upset, one reason is because the definition of success and failure is such in my mind, based on the definition, the upset and the grief stems from it. So you're saying that a shift in the mindset, one about how we define ourselves and essentially to separate ourselves from our results. I am not my results. I am not failure. Like I am a great person, good person, whatever empowers me. And then perhaps looking at that incident as an incident, and then let's say taking learnings from it. And so I understand that, you know, shifting this mindset and really being compassionate towards ourselves and not, you know, just scolding ourselves in our own head, you know, you're bad, you didn't do this. This is, so that's like a large mindset, a fundamental mindset shift that you think will be helpful. And that, I mean, I agree with you, of course, I'm not an expert here, but my question as somebody who's experienced these myself, is while that mind shift occurs eventually, slowly, as I incorporate this belief, and I am feeling the grief of losing something important to me, bad scores, not getting, you get that. So while that shift is occurring, what would you say are some ways to deal with that failure such that I don't have to, you know, experience the cruel, the pain that comes with it sometimes.
Right. So, of course, like you said, that everybody has their own journey of going through an event that is so upsetting as this one. So I think some of the ways of maybe dealing with it is, like I said, that reminding yourself of your strengths, right? Firstly, talking about, so if you have to also look at maybe this particular incident of maybe not getting into the B school of your choice, right? So why did that happen? You know, so probably because I have not scored the percentile that I was required to qualify and, you know, get admission into the B school. Yeah. Now, what does that score actually mean? You know, so when I'm saying that it is a bad score, what does it actually mean? Does it mean that I have not answered a single question in the paper? You know, does it mean that there is not a single section of the, you know, exam that might have gone well? Probably there are some sections that I might have done well. It's just the score is just maybe not as much for me to qualify into the B school of my choice. Similarly, for an internship, you know, so if there is some assessment that I had to go through for it, yeah, was there no part of the assessment that I cleared or that I did well or that I felt confident about, yeah? So evaluating it in that way, also looking through your journey and seeing that what were some of the things that I did well in this process, what were some things that I could have maybe strengthened or I could have worked on further, that could also be one of the ways of looking at it. And like Piyusha also mentioned, the whole perspective of self-compassion. I think that is something so important because while you are navigating through this journey also, it's important to be compassionate and tell yourself that, you know, maybe there are some things that I'm good at and there are these points that I need to work with, rather than labeling yourself as a failure, maybe having this kind of an approach to it and perspective.
Definitely. And it sounds really helpful because we often just ignore the good parts when we're in that the failure zone. And I think it's really helpful to just remind ourselves that we have strengths and, you know, we're really good at some things. Okay, thanks so much. Let's go on to the next question, which is that often at B schools, lack of time, pressure to balance placement preparation with academic rigor and excellence, establishing a network and, you know, building long-lasting friendships. These are issues that often stress and worry students who are at B schools. Could you take those up in turn and, you know, share some perspective on how we could handle all of these and yet have a pleasant experience while we're at it?
So I think when we talk about, you know, balancing all of these things together, we may have to look at time management skills. And this actually reminds me of an analogy, which is, you know, commonly known, which is of a glass jar. You know, the analogy is that so the glass jar is a representation of the time that we have, you know, during the day and the time that we have at hand. We put in, you know, large stones in that glass jar. And these large stones essentially, you know, represent the important areas of our life, which is our career, our important friendships, you know, our goals, etc. And then, you know, we put in the small pebbles, which are then, you know, a representation of other things that may not be as, you know, important as the big stones, but they're also essential. They're also crucial for our life, which can be, you know, going out with friends, you know, having some fun times. So ideally, you know, the analogy explains that the way we put these things inside the glass jar is important, and the you know, the time in which we put these things in the jar is important. So we need to give more priority to the big stones of our life and how we tend to organize our day around these important commitments is what, you know, defines how we are able to maintain a balance between the important areas of our life. So I think the prioritization that what is important to me right now, asking yourself that question, and what is it that which areas I need to focus on, how am I going to then, you know, organize my day as per these important areas is something that we have to get at.
Okay. Do you want to share your perspective on this, Prerna, if you have a different one?
Yeah. So I think Piyusha also summed it up well. But I think if I also have to elaborate on the question related to networking and making friendships and long-lasting friendships. So certainly, I think we are all living in a very fast-paced world where we are all working towards our goals and we are all trying our best to maintain relationships that are important to us, right? And that is also important because we all need this support around us, yeah? So there may be times when it may be very difficult to maintain these friendships or keep in touch with the people who matter to us, because, you know, that is also something that is very important for us and it is likely to have an impact on our lives. Yeah. So I think it's important to also then identify that, you know, using the same analogy, I would say that important who are, like, I understand who are those big important rocks in your life. You know, so when you're talking about networking also, when you're talking about the people you're meeting also, try and understand who is important for you, who's actually being that support for you. And also if there are any conflicts, if there is anything that is happening while you're maintaining these relationships with them, it's important to have a conversation about it, right? So there are difficult moments in these friendships that we have sometimes, and it is important to have a conversation without blaming the other person. So I think, you know, one of the ideal ways of having the conversation is talking about how you feel rather than blaming. So just saying, I feel hurt rather than you hurt me. So I think that is a more non-blaming way of putting things across. So this can be one of the ways of maintaining the friendships, talking about sharing life experiences with one another, supporting each other through distress, through difficult times. So I think that can be one of the ways of maintaining these long relationships that are important for us.
Right. So if we were to, let's say, give a two-step guide to the audience, number one would be figure out what's important. And number two would be invest your energies accordingly. Right? Is that correct?
That's absolutely correct.
Okay, awesome. Moving on, many students and professionals operate in highly competitive environments, and when they feel that they're not doing well enough, they may begin questioning their worth, just how we discussed in the first question, which is, you know, what good am I if I can't do XYZ? It could be anything. And especially in business schools, in fact, there's something called the Stanford syndrome, if I remember correctly, which is how students feel in an extremely competitive environment. They feel worthless sometimes. And, you know, unsatisfied, inferior, similar emotions. So one way, as we discussed, to deal with this would be to disassociate yourselves with your results and talk about your strengths. Is there any other thing you can talk about in terms of people compare? So students and professionals comparing themselves with each other and sort of having a negative life experience due to those comparisons. Would you like to take that up?
Yeah, certainly. I think that is what happens in a competitive environment, you know. So when we talk about competitive environments, there are these yardsticks that are there all over, which compel us. So even if we say that, you know, it has to be your own individual self and your own individual abilities, we do not exist in isolation, right? So there will be these comparisons that will keep happening. I will have this feeling that, you know, my friend is doing better than me. Somebody else may be doing better than me. And it is absolutely valid or maybe natural to maybe feel so. But at the same time, also realizing that how everybody has a different journey. So maybe that is also one thing that is, you know, important to remind yourself of, that everybody may be having a different journey. Your friend might be having a different journey, which you might not be aware of. You are having a different journey, which others are not aware of. So I think it's very important to also have that empathy or have that understanding that everybody has a different journey. And at the same time, like I said, yes, remembering your strengths and particularly having your own path towards your goal. You know, so one thing that we often talk about in our counseling sessions is that, you know, if your goal, so if we are looking at a scale of 0 to 10 and your goal is at 10, where are you currently, right? Are you at 0? You're surely not at 0 because that means that you're not making any effort at all, right? So you are probably at 2 or 3, maybe, right? So you are doing something because of which you are at 2 or 3. How about then figuring out how do I get to 4 or how do I get to 5? Yeah. And all of those things will be my own experiences, my own journey. Yeah. So I will be the creator of my own journey in this whole process. Yeah. So bringing back the focus to my own self, my strengths, my journey, what do I need to work on? So I think that can be one of the ways of dealing with it and, you know, reminding yourself of your strengths and having compassion. So I think these can be some of the ways of coping with a situation like this.
I think to add to what Prerna said, I would also like to, you know, mention that when we talk about comparisons, it's a very natural and it's a very normal thing that happens because we as human beings, we need some standards to evaluate ourselves. We constantly want to evaluate ourselves. And for us to be able to have some standards, we look at other people. We compare ourselves with peers. We compare ourselves with other students in our batch. And that helps us to evaluate ourselves. So essentially, that is the you know, purpose as to why we compare ourselves with other people. But then here we need to recognize that, you know, what is a healthy amount of comparison and where is it getting healthy, unhealthy. So it will get unhealthy when it starts interfering, your abilities, your day-to-day, life areas. And then we need to then, look at, like Prerna said, how can we then build that comparison internally? How do I evaluate myself from who I was before and who I am now and who I would like to be in the future? So can we look at that way of evaluating ourselves? So I think that is something that is important. That it is important to recognize comparison as something that is a very natural process. But then if we do want to evaluate ourselves, why not evaluate ourselves with who we were earlier and who we want to be rather than with someone else, because two individuals can never be the same. They're always going to have different strengths, different qualities, different approaches to looking at things. So why not, evaluate yourself with yourself rather than doing it externally?
Yeah, so
this is also one approach that we can take.
Definitely. I mean, thanks so much for reminding our audience, because often when we are in business schools or working environments, we completely forget that these two people who, although sit in the same class or work at the same thing, have very different, they could have very, very different life journeys. And so just reminding ourselves that this is not the same question. You can't compare the answer if the question is different, you know. I mean, thanks so much for shedding light on that. And with that, we have a question from the audience. This is Sharmista Datta, who's asking. She works in a male-dominated area and she doesn't see much career progress in that field. And for her, this eventually increases anxiety. And some days are so difficult for her to really get up and go to office because of this. So do you want to share some perspective on how she and other people feeling the same way can deal with this?
Yeah, certainly. I think thanks for sharing that question. I think it is very, very relevant, particularly like she's saying that she works in a is a professional in at a workplace that is mostly dominated by men, or probably, you know, her most of her colleagues are men. Right. And I completely understand what she's feeling. So I think what we also need to understand that in a scenario like this, the problem is not internal, you know, it is actually external. The fact that she's feeling this way, she is feeling very anxious about her growth, or, sometimes individuals do feel that is because, you are looked at from a certain perspective because of your gender. That is what happens, particularly when a profession is, the number of professionals in that particular profession are of a certain gender. The other gender is likely to feel isolated, or likely to feel sidelined, likely to feel that they do not have enough opportunities. So I completely understand where that is coming from. Yeah. So I think in a scenario like this, we all need to somewhere understand that the problem here is not internal, it is external, unfortunately. Yeah. But I think in response to Sharmishtha, did I get the name correctly? Yes. So I think in response to Sharmishtha, I would just say that I understand that, you know, this is happening because you are being made to feel a certain way because of who you are as a person. But at the same time, do realize that you have strengths as an individual, which is why you are there, right? And I know, I completely get that it is a very challenging environment, very competitive environment. You are likely to feel that you do not have opportunities. But I think do realize your strengths. This is something that is external. You do not have to feel responsible for being weak. You do not have to blame yourself that you are feeling anxious for no reason. However, at the same time, please do, be aware of your strengths. Be aware of why you are over there, how you are over there. That is because of your strengths. And the reason you are able to survive there is because of your strengths. So I think that is what I would encourage or give a message to her. Yeah, Piyusha, please feel free to add if you wish to.
And I think with respect to whatever she has been feeling, the distress that she has been feeling, there is always professional help available. So if you would like to discuss more about your concerns, about your feelings, about your thoughts, in a non-judgmental space, you can feel free to access professional help.
Thanks. Thanks so much for answering that question. Next, let's take up stress and anxiety. They can be two very different experiences, and students waiting to hear from colleges they applied to or from companies they applied to, people waiting to find a job of their choice, they may feel anxious in the process. What do you think contributes to anxiety in the first place? And what do you think are some effective ways of dealing with anxiety and stress?
Okay. So I think it is very understandable to feel anxious when we are, anticipating, looking forward to getting a job, and we are actually in the waiting process, because there is a lot of uncertainty, a lot of unpredictability around this whole experience, because we don't know where we would, whether or not we would get a job, whether or not we would, land up in the B school that we've applied for. So anxiety is a very, very normal physiological response to uncertain situations. So it's very natural for everybody to feel anxious, and different people feel anxiety in different ways. So some of them might experience it more physically, some of them might experience it more in terms of their cognitions, some of them may just, experience fear as an emotion, or some of them may experience all the three at the same time. So it's important to firstly recognize these signs of distress, to recognize that you are feeling anxious, and some of the ways that we can, physically or physiologically cope with it is by engaging in some relaxation exercises, by engaging in some distraction activities. So if you are feeling very anxious, then you can sit in one, quiet space and just try to focus on your breathing. Just try to regulate your breathing. You can also distract yourself by, say talking to your friends or engaging in some games or activities that help you take your mind off those anxious thoughts for some time. And it's also important to, sort of understand why you are feeling anxious on a thought level. It's important to sort of question that, why am I feeling anxious? What are the possible outcomes of this particular situation? So what is the worst that is likely to happen? So the worst that is likely to possibly happen is that I may not get that job, or I may not get into the B school that I have applied for. And if something like this happens, how can I be prepared to deal with such a situation? What are some of the other options that I can explore? So I think it's important to ask oneself these questions once you feel, you know, physiologically a little relaxed in a much better space. Then you can question yourself and understand, you know, where is this anxiety coming from.
Also adding to that, you know, so if we have to just look at anxiety as an emotion, because Piyusha also talked about the thoughts, right? So all of these emotions, they have an impact on how we are perceiving situations or how we are looking at situations. And I'm going to the worst possible situation, right? When I'm anxious about something, when I am, can you hear me now? Yes. So I said that the most common thought that comes to us is that we will be amidst the worst possible situation, right? Maybe if I'm awaiting the results of something, maybe the thought that the way the anxiety is having an impact on my thought is that, you know, I'm going to fail. That is the thought, you know, so it's the worst possible outcome. In that scenario, just to give an example, right? However, the outcome might not be that I would fail. I would just probably do badly in one of the sections of the exam, maybe. Or probably I don't perform well to maybe get a certain percentile that I'm expecting. That is what it would be, right? So again, you know, reminding yourself that, you know, this is maybe what the anxiety is making me feel. However, is the situation like that? You know, is the situation really something like, you know, it's going to take me to the worst possible outcome? Or are things not likely to be as bad as I'm actually imagining them to be or perceiving them to be, right? So it would be important to also reflect on that. There are times when situations are real. By this, I don't mean to say that everybody who is feeling anxious for no reason. Or is unrealistically anxious, and there are times when situations are scary for sure, but at the same time, reflecting whether they are as bad as we are feeling them to be is something that is likely to be helpful.
Right, thanks so much. That feels really helpful. In fact, the charting out the possibilities and really then figuring out how I can deal with each in turn, I think seems very helpful as a direct action people could do. If you're watching this video and you're feeling anxious, just go ahead and make a tree, make possibilities, you know, 5 things that could happen, 2 things that could happen. And what am I going to do if X happens, Y happens, Z happens? And once you're done with that, I personally did it about 2 months back. I made that tree and I felt so relieved. I can't tell you. And another action that you could do, folks who are watching this, is like Piyusha said, engage in a relaxing activity. Go play whatever game you like, watch whatever movie you like, whatever relaxes you. Exercises, like Piyusha mentioned, you know, just focusing on your breath, sit in a quiet room. So just engage in physical remedies also, and mentally also relieve yourself by charting out possibilities that you're worried about that could happen, and then taking them up in turn, acting on them, figuring that bit out. And with that, we come to the next question. Rohan from the audience is asking, how do we balance burnout versus pushing our limits? That's the question.
Right. Thank you for the question again. I think this is a very valid question that, you know, sometimes we talk about taking care of our own self, our mental health. But again, the other thought, you know, after that is that, you know, will it make me very complacent? Will it make me relaxed? Will it, you know, pull me back from working towards my goal, right? So I completely understand, you know, the whole idea behind asking something or maybe having a reflection on something like this also. It's very valid. Now, again, when it comes to burnout, or when it comes to something that you're doing and it is causing a burnout, we need to see what about that task is actually causing a burnout, right? I understand that sometimes whatever we are doing, we are genuinely passionate about it, right? We genuinely want to do something in our lives. We genuinely want to work towards our goal. But at the same time, you know, it can be a very exhausting process, you know. So at in those scenarios, it's important to also see that what exactly is causing the burnout. Yeah, is it the task in itself that is causing the burnout? If the task in itself is causing the burnout, then maybe I need to look at my motivation of engaging in something that is causing a burnout, right? For instance, my ability as a professional is counseling, yeah? But say I'm doing something that is outside my, capabilities, or that is something that I'm not interested in, then definitely I'm going to go, experience a burnout, or I'm going to experience a fatigue. Because it's just not a match to the abilities that I possess as an individual, right? So similarly, when you're experiencing a burnout, try and maybe reflect what exactly is causing the burnout. Is it the time that you're engaging in that activity that is causing the burnout? Is it the nature of the task in itself that is causing the burnout? Is it in line with my abilities, or is it in line with the motivation that I have as an individual? And by this, I also mean that is that motivation coming from comparing somebody else's journey with mine, or is it my own goal or is it somebody else's goal? If somebody else didn't do this, then what would my goal have been? Would it have been the same or would it have been something else? Yeah. So looking at your own motivation, while you're experiencing burnout or looking at what is causing burnout, that is important. Similarly, pushing yourself to also do something. Again, that also would depend on how motivated are you to do this or where is that motivation actually stemming from? Yeah. Is it stemming from my own will to do something for myself or it is stemming from an external pressure? It can be pressure that is coming from family, from peers, from the whole competitive environment that we are in. Yeah. So I think both these situations, whether it is pushing yourself, whether it is experiencing burnout, yeah, it is okay to work towards your goal and it is natural to feel burnout, right? But in both these scenarios, try and reflect what exactly is happening in the process. Yeah. So I think that would be my answer to this question.
I think it is great that you're being able to understand that you're experiencing burnout because this in itself shows that then there is, the scope to work on the signs of burnout. So when we talk about burnout, what are you experiencing, on a physical level, on an emotional level, on a cognitive level? And then how can you devise ways to work towards this? So if you are experiencing a burnout, then will taking short breaks while the task that you are doing help? Or will maybe, taking a few days off help? So what is likely to help is also something that you may have to figure out in terms of coping with burnout. So firstly, understanding how the burnout has been impacting me physically, emotionally, and cognitively. And then what are some of the ways in which, I can work to feel better and get back?
So if I understand correctly, when it comes to balancing burnout versus pushing your limits, are you suggesting that it is a function of experimenting? So figuring out if taking a break here or if going slow because this is something different from my abilities. So figuring out if those will help or let's say trying something. Do I understand correctly? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. So that is perfectly. Now when you're talking about striking a balance between both of these things, I think it is a very individual journey, So what is burnout for me may not be burnout for somebody else. What is pushing myself beyond a limit for me may not be the same for somebody else, right? So it's a very subjective experience. I think what I would say over here is to just do an internal reflection. Firstly, the fact that we are talking about building a balance also over here, let us first reflect on what our definitions are only of both these things. So when we are saying burnout or when we are saying pushing yourself beyond the limit also, what does that actually mean for us? Pushing yourself beyond a limit meaning what? Where is the motivation to do something like that coming from? Mm-hmm. I need to be really passionate about something to mm-hmm. be able to do that. And if I'm not feeling passionate enough, mm-hmm. then maybe I need to reflect on what is happening in that process. Is it something that is not in line with my abilities or what I want to do with my life? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that is something that we have to reflect upon. in, you know, when we are looking at both of these concepts. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that brings me to a related question. Sankalp was just asking on the chat, how do I continuously stay passionate? And I think that's related to your answer about think about where your motivations are coming from, really. Are they even motivators, or are you simply pursuing somebody else's goal, else's dream?
Yes, absolutely.
It's also important to understand that, yes, we might be passionate about something, but that doesn't mean that we don't experience burnout, like Prema said earlier. And as human beings, we may not always at the same time be able to feel equally passionate about something. And there can be times when we don't feel, that energetic or that passionate about something. And that is also okay, because these changes, are a part of our life, and we cannot constantly feel the same way all the time. As human beings, we experience a lot of things every day. We have different experiences. And some days can be, some days don't have to be as good as, the days that are. So that's important to keep in mind. So maybe we won't be able to feel passionate about something all the time, and that's okay.
And Prena, I want to circle back to the point you mentioned regarding doing things that may be different from our abilities so far, and then feeling burned out in that process. The question really is that a lot of people, especially B school students, or in fact students wanting to go to a B school, may have to learn skills different from the ones they have, for example, someone really good at literature or someone really good at math having to explore the other side. So English or literature, or let's say preparing for cases, lots of different skills. So when we are in fact doing something that's different from our abilities and feeling burnout, how do you think one should go about handling that?
Okay. So maybe what I understand from your question, Ocean, is that, like I completely understand somebody who is aspiring to go to a B school. And if you have to look at the entrance exam, the CAT for that matter, it requires like a combination of different skills, right? So you need the analytical ability, the logical ability, there is some numerical ability that is involved. Then there is a general awareness that is involved, right? So there are these multiple skills that are getting tested, and I completely understand, so I may relate more to numerical ability, but not to something else. And I understand that maybe I have to work harder to achieve that, or, to maybe work on that, something that may not be in line with whatever I'm doing. And in that process, I'm likely to feel exhausted. I'm likely to feel tired. I'm likely to feel demotivated also. That is likely to happen. But at the same time, if we can just maybe remind ourselves of the larger goal, if you're working somewhere also, it may be possible that you're giving multiple responsibilities under the same job role. Yeah. There will be some things that you will be very good at. There will be some things that you will feel that, okay, this is something that I still need to work at. Yeah. But at the same time, if I work at all my skills, then what is the end result of it? Or what am I likely to get if I, work at all of these skills? What is the end result? What about achieving that end result is actually motivating to me? What does it mean to me? So it's important to reflect, because if I'm working on something that is not in line with my abilities, I need to then be motivated by something, right? For instance, if I'm in a job, I know that, there are some skills that are not according to my abilities, but still, I think I will be motivated by the fact that I will be looked at as a trustworthy employee if I work on all the skills in to some extent. Maybe I may not be the best at everything, but if I achieve like a considerable, significant competence in the skills that I'm expected to deliver, then I may be looked at as a trustworthy employee. And being a trustworthy employee means something to me, right? So that is how I would like to put it, that if I have to feel motivated enough to work towards something, then what is it about the end result which will be motivating for me? Yeah. And look at your own personal reasons rather than something that may be inspired. It is okay to be inspired, but if it is largely that and less of this, then it causes a problem or it causes distress. So I think that is how I would like to answer this question.
Right. So setting your motivations is a key part of transitioning into something that we don't know yet, a different ability, right. Different skill set.
Yes.
And and let's say in that process, if we are still feeling burned out at times, then should we sort of circle back to your point about finding the cause of the burnout? What is it that's exactly causing the burnout? You find it and then you work on it. Is that the way forward?
Correct. Absolutely.
Okay. Piyusha, would you want to share some perspective here? Or are we good to go?
No, we can go ahead.
Okay, awesome. So Divit Arora is asking, how do we actually find time for ourselves after scoring a placement from a top B school, especially in a post-COVID era?
Sorry, I didn't get the question actually. So how do we take care of ourselves after?
Find time for ourselves.
Huh.
After being placed in the post COVID era.
After being placed.
Okay. So I just want to understand. So is the job going to be very stressful, and is it going to leave you with very little time? If yes, then it's important to set aside some time during the day for yourself. It may not be a lot, but maybe 15 to 30 minutes is something that we can look at, wherein we set some time aside for what is known as self-care. So how can we take care of ourselves? What are the activities that we can do which help us take care of ourselves physically as well as mentally? So that is very crucial. So, just setting a ritual for yourself, either at the start of the day or at the end of the day, before you go to sleep. So maybe it can be, something that you really enjoy doing, like listening to music or maybe reading a book. Sometimes people also find, gymming or working out very relaxing. So can you make some time for that during your day, during your busy schedule? And like we also saw earlier, we all, get the same time. But what really matters is how we place ourselves during the day. What are the things that we focus on? How do we schedule our day that really helps us organize our day better and also leave some time to self-care, to taking care of ourselves mentally and physically. I think that is one way of looking at it.
And also adding to what Piyusha also said, you talked about the COVID times where I think what is also happening is that most of us, the routines that we followed previously are very different from what they are right now. Most of us work from home. And again, when that also happens, the whole boundary between personal and professional gets very blurred. So little strategies about, because what happens is while you're working from a workplace, there is a clear boundary. You go there, you travel, you commute, leave the workplace, and you leave things behind, right? That kind of a space doesn't exist at home sometimes, right? So it's important to create those physical boundaries also to be, to remind yourself of that, of those boundaries, right? For instance, if I have a designated space for my work at home, right? Can I make a rule for myself that once I'm out of the space, I'm not going to think about work. I will just disconnect for some time. And then once I come back to the space, then I will work. And then once I leave the space for maybe 5 to 10 minutes, once in a while, then probably I will disconnect from work. So it's important to create those boundaries. Have some days that you might be taking an off for your own self. So sometimes we feel that we might have to take leaves only when there is something to attend to at home or something or we are not well, right? But I think promise yourself one mental health care leave, once in 2 to 3 months, if that is possible, at least, So I think these are some ways of taking care of your own self. in the current times.
Right. I think this is what a brilliant idea. I mean, a lot of us just underestimate mental health so much that to a lot of us, the very idea of a mental health leave would be like, oh, what's this? Is this something? But it definitely seems so important given the times we're in and the things we're going through. And with that, I want to really delve a little bit deeper into what the pandemic has created for us. You know, the pandemic has sort of created distance, more distance, like within people, within friends, communities, and not just personal, even professional. And really a significant change in the way things are, the way things are done. So not being able to meet loved ones or staying with loved ones all the time, you know, studying remotely, online classes all day, they may get boring sometimes, not having enough parties like before, not enough fun activities like before, or not just, you know, touring, going out. All of this has really, I think, impacted the well-being of a lot of us. And as experts, people who understand this space, I want to ask you what you think are some ways of being content with the way life is going on just now. And, you know, managing our work, our education, our commitments, but also being content. What would your take on that be?
I think surely, like you mentioned, it has only increased the distance between us. And, you know, we constantly crave for that social connection. We always crave to be around us. And, you know, definitely being isolated in one... am I audible? Am I audible?
You are.
Yeah. You know, definitely being alone or living with your family can have its own challenges. So surely in terms of, you know, if you are living alone, if, you know, you are isolated, hostel, so some of the, you have to find some of the ways in which you can stay connected with your loved ones or with your friends. So a lot of times I think, you know, students are still having their online classes. You know, there is no interaction with peers in a classroom setup. And that can mean that, you know, you have to attend classes on your own. There is no support. So exploring ways in which, you know, you can stay connected with peers in terms of, you know, having groups, having having discussions online, exploring ways in which you can stay connected with your family members, with your, so, you know, setting aside some part of the day for interacting with your support systems is also something that will help us, you know, stay connected and maintain these social relationships.
Right. Prerna, would you like to share some thoughts there?
Yes. Certainly. I think one of the things that we keep hearing is social distancing, particularly in the current times. But again, we also need to understand that it is not, social distancing does not mean emotional distancing, right? So I think we may be, you know, physically disconnected from each other or isolated from each other, but at the same time, it is important to connect with each other emotionally. And thankfully, we are in a time where there is technology, where we can keep in touch with each other, when we can make use of technology also. There is a lot of, you know, there are so many things that have come up, particularly in the current times, for us to make use of these resources. Now, if you're in college now, I think even going back to college in the current times, it is a very different experience, right? So some of them are maybe still following that hybrid model of learning where, you know, some students are learning from campus, some are again back home. So I think that is also, and you also miss the fest, the you know, activities that are there in the college. The whole atmosphere is something that, you know, may not be there, at least for now. So it can be a very isolating experience. So, you know, one of the things that can be done is, you know, talking to each other. So now this needs to be done along with your other friends, your peers, right? Motivating them to form a group online or maybe share resources. So it's very important to also ensure that there is some sort of a sharing. in a time like this. The sharing can be anything. So the sharing need not just be about academic, resources or online resources or any textbooks or anything that you would want to circulate. It can also be about life experiences, because this is like a common reality for a lot of people. Yeah. So what I may be going through may be very similar to what somebody else may be going through. And if we have to share with each other, if we talk to each other about how we are coping with our challenges, it is likely to help somebody. Similarly, if somebody else tells me about how they are coping, it is likely to help me if I do not feel as equipped to cope with that challenge in my life. Right. So I think the sharing and having rituals. So I think, like Piyusha was also saying, she was talking about spending time together. So having these rituals as a family, with your friends, chatting once in a while, just reminiscing older days. Sometimes we feel if we just make a video call, what do we talk? Just have a ritual that you will reminisce your older days, or you'll reminisce something that means something to you. So I think there are these rituals, there are these little things that help us form these connections with people in the current time. So yeah, hope that helps.
Definitely. I mean, instead of, let's say, just talking one-on-one, you're saying actively forming that group, having those multiple people on board and connecting with them would in fact help us recreate the kind of experiences we used to have earlier. And I think that's worth the effort, really, you know. And with that, I want to shift the focus to exactly the point where we started, which was, the suspected suicide of the student at IIM Ahmedabad. The question is, in your opinion, if somebody is having suicidal thoughts, what is it that they can do to help themselves?
So I think suicide thoughts are a reflection of the immense hopelessness and a sense of despair that you might feel about your life. And yes, there are some ways in which you can manage yourself during these times, and you may feel very overwhelmed, you may feel very vulnerable. So it's important to try not to be alone when you significantly notice that you're having suicidal thoughts, or you have thoughts of ending your life. When you notice these thoughts coming up to you, and you feel the urge to maybe act on these thoughts, it's very important to try to distract yourself, by maybe talking to a loved one, seeking some support. And it doesn't have to be that you have to go and tell them about your distress or share, everything about your life to them. But this can just be so that you don't stay in a space where there's nobody around, and you basically stay connected with someone. So maybe you can go to a friend's room, you can just sit in a place where there are family members, so that you feel a little distracted, you feel like you are not alone, and you may just wait for that urge to act on those thoughts pass by in this process. Because a lot of times when we talk about suicidal thoughts and urges, they can be momentary as well, and when you are in that moment, they can be very, very strong. So it's important to recognize that you've started feeling hopeless, you've started feeling helpless, and that you may get this urge. So it's important to take action and try not to be alone during these times. So this is one of the ways in which you can help yourself.
Also, adding to what Piyusha said, she was talking about while experiencing these thoughts, the distress being extremely immense, right? So that is what happens, So when these emotions, when we are experiencing emotions like these, they're extremely intense, yeah? And that makes it very difficult to cope with those emotions. Yeah. So just take a moment, calm down. Like I said, that it's important to also soothe yourself in these moments. Just take a minute. Just sit down somewhere. Take a deep breath. Relax for a while. You can even lie down on your bed. Just breathe normally. Lie down on your bed. Try to soothe yourself during those moments. Also, like Piyusha also said, talk to a loved one. So talk to somebody who you trust. It is, if you're comfortable sharing, please share. But at the same time, please know that help is available. So I think what happens also is that when somebody experiences suicidal thoughts, it is because of a concern or difficulty that they have been dealing with for a very long time. So it is important to seek professional help when that happens, and there is help available. There are helplines that offer counseling, that offer support for distress that you know people go through. We are associated with iCall, which is again one such helpline that offers psychological help. Suicide is one of the issues that we work with. Apart from that, also there are quite a few helplines who offer that help. So sometimes if you're not comfortable seeing a mental health professional, there are people who are comfortable going to mental health professionals, seeking counseling face to face for the distress that they're going through. If you're not comfortable doing that, then it may also help in reaching out to a helpline. The reason why I'm suggesting a helpline is that the help is more readily available because it's just a number you need to dial. And besides, most of the helplines that are available, they assure you of confidentiality, sometimes anonymity also, where you do not have to, you know, reveal your identifying details. So I think iCall is one such helpline where you can share your concerns very anonymously. So I think please know that help is available, and it is something that can be addressed for sure. So I think that is a message that I would like to convey here today. Yeah.
I think reaching out to professional help will not just help you in managing the immediate distress, the immediate thoughts of suicide, but it will also help you to address, you know, what is causing. Like Prerna said, there is a cause to these suicidal thoughts. There may be some experiences that have been very, very difficult, due to which you are feeling very hopeless. So it's important to also address these experiences, to talk about them in a safe and non-judgmental space. So iCall also provides a very safe and a non-judgmental space. So you will not be judged for whatever difficulties or whatever concerns that you talk about. So it can be related to anything.
Right. So really addressing the cause would be understanding that people who are inclined to think about suiciding may find themselves feeling hopeless, helpless. And you explain to our audience that help is in fact available. We may not see it immediately. So talking to our loved ones, not being alone, just people who we trust, speaking with them is one way of helping ourselves. The other way is we seek professional help, and we don't have to worry about, you know, our identity, etc. There'll be one person who won't judge us and will actually invest in helping us get out of this phase. Really, really wonderful hearing that. I want to conclude the episode we're doing today by asking you the final question, which is, what is it that I can do, that everybody can do, to make sure they keep mentally healthy? For example, there are a lot of medical checks. People go for full body checkups, but I've never heard people going to a mental health professional and saying, just check up on me, you know, tell me what's... So what are some ways we can keep a healthy life mentally, in your view?
Yeah. So I think thank you so much for that question also. Like you said, that it is so important. We are so much aware about our own physical health, and because of the conversations that happen around physical health, and because there is no stigma associated with physical health, we also know where to go, how to go, what to do for our physical health also. But again, sadly, mental health and the stigma associated with it, we do not know. And like I said, that there is absolutely, sometimes there may be no, significance to it, or you may feel that it is not important to maybe look at it, right? But at the same time, it is definitely important to look at it, yeah. So I think if we also, if we look at something like the healthy mind platter, it's important to, spend time doing something productive, but at the same time, a downtime is also important. So, you know, it is okay to have some time in the day when you're not doing anything. That is absolutely okay. Maintaining a gratitude journal, something that's very relevant in the current times. Yeah. And just doing a check, you know, what am I feeling right now? I think that is also something that is likely to help.
I think, again, when we talk about mental health, we feel that when we, you know, when we are very distressed or when things are not going right, only then we have to, you know, look for help or seek professional help. But you know, it's okay. You can actually, you know, seek professional help for early signs of distress. And the earlier you do it, you know, the more capable and empowered you will feel to deal with the stressors of your life. So definitely seeking professional help is also one option. And it just doesn't have to be done when you are feeling very low or when you've reached that brink and you've reached that point, but it can be done when you start recognizing early signs of distress.
Right. I want to thank you both so much for sharing your perspective with us. I think these were really valuable ideas. A lot of them new for our audience perhaps, but really, really helpful. My final request to the audience would be that you know, please don't just passively listen to the video and go back and do nothing. This video has a lot of questions for you to consider. Often we just underestimate the act of reflecting, just sitting and thinking. But it's surprising how powerful it can be and how it can help us. So my urge for the audience would be to go back, start reflecting. And if you're at a point where these are huge problems for you, take help. iCall is one option for help. There would be other. Go wherever you think you want to, and take care of yourselves. Thank you so much for joining in.
Thank you.